Can I also get the access to post the slides, please?
You will have to share it at your end. You'll have to just share it.
Oh, I can do that? Okay.
Yes. Does it have an audio?
No audio.
Okay, so just share. Click on the share and you'll be fine.
Fantastic. Okay. All right. So firstly, thank you very much for joining in and giving me an opportunity to talk about something that I am extremely passionate. I used to be a lot more passionate about AI, but I think now it's my purpose. That's something that I have been dabbling, especially starting of this year. I was focusing, taking off to find out what is it that I really need to focus decade. And I do that every starting of a decade. And this time I really wanted to know the purpose and the meaning of my existence. And how do I really take this AI to everyone, especially children? And so here I am to talk about how AI is literally everything in everyday life and in everything that we do. So I have a request before we start off, if you can keep a few sheets of paper with you and a pen, or even a pencil, that's really going to be useful and we would be using it in our conversation. Because that exercise is super critical in understanding the neuroscience of AI.
May I request everybody else to please mute during the webinar, and you can actually unmute yourself whenever you want to speak.
Sure. And may I also, you know, request that we have all the questions towards the end of the session, until of course you have something very pressing and you want to get a clarity during the flow of the session. Very happy to maybe see a raised hand or your question in the chat box and we will answer. We definitely, I have planned in my entire 1 hour, 5 to 10 minutes time to have any questions that we might have during the time that we hear together. So saying that, once again, let's start off with Emotional Intelligence and Neuroscience Masterclass for coaches, consultants, and trainers. Extremely happy to be talking and introducing about Genos, like how we say dog's ears. I think Genos has literally been dog's ears in AI assessment, research, and product development. We founded this in 2002. It was founded by Dr. Benjamin Palmer from Australia. And we definitely are one of the leading emotional intelligence assessment and solution providing organization. We have currently around 7,500 practitioners certified across the globe. And our major research partner, even today we work, is Swinburne University in Australia. So I'm sure you all know Daniel Goleman in 1995 came up with this book and which sort of shook and jolted the whole world in looking at or even thinking about EQ and just not the IQ that we were very, very acclimatized with. So from 95 to 2002, not much of a difference because we started our research right from there. So it might sound a little bragging about Genos, but I love to do this part, so allow me to. In fact, we are the only company which provides AI assessments focusing specifically on how I show up every day. So you would actually keep listening to me on the word show up many times during this 1 hour. And trust me, that is all it is in terms of our practical everyday behavior on how we show up. So we have a wide range of coaching, facilitation, and training. All the three verticals, methodologies of doing AI based on our assessments. However, I think with all these good job that we've been doing, we're very proud to say that we have we are top 20 companies as per the Training Industry Awards in assessment and evaluation in 2017, 2018, and also 2019. I couldn't update the slide because this I was doing a session in November. So it's 2017 and 18 and as well as 19. So that's 3 years in a row, top 20. We also definitely are, with CCE and with every certification or work that you do for GNOS, you can get CCE units awarded post the certification. We are also the one of the global business partner for ICF. In fact, I think the chief science officer based out of US, I forget his name, actually blessed the assessment on after thorough examination of our research, our assessments and what we have done. So that's a very big thing for us to be associated with ICF for coaching vertical. And finally, I think this is the biggest one because it is the big daddy himself, Daniel Goleman, who actually founded this consortium for research on emotional intelligence in organization. So what happened post 1995 was there are a lot of people who were coming up with EI methodologies and products and ways. However, we were not sure if that was the way it should be. So this consortium were formed to check literally like policing to see the quality of EI and what we do. So we're very much part of this. And I think the consortium has approved only 7 in the world and we are one of the 7. So that's about GNOS. And you can see that we have around 7,500 practitioners around the world. And the whole idea is about, you know, wanting to make a difference in developing people and equipping them in their lives. So this is about what we do. And we also, you know, say that behaviors is what everyone can see, everyone can notice. And it's easy to work upon our behaviors either by getting coached or by receiving feedback within the organizations to make ourselves better. So other than all these that we do, you know, let me not only talk about, you know, I think like any organization, we are here in to make profits without a doubt. But other than that, the reason that I personally chose GNOS to get certified is because of their social responsibility programs. We do a lot of webinars, sessions, hosting free assessments for people. And recently, the one which is currently going on is the Ireland Mindfulness Challenge. The reason being that Ireland as a country has been notified around 35% of stress-related issues. And we are actually reaching out to do a marathon session in terms of helping people overcome stress. So, for example, the recent one that we did was the Mindful Leader, the mindful and emotional intelligence salesperson. And today, of course, we are doing emotional intelligence and neuroscience masterclass. And other than that, we also do a lot of things, especially programming like journaling, personal vision. And we also have an app for that. We have it for the GNOS certified practitioners. And something that we take a lot of pride in helping people understanding EI. In the real world, it's all about, you know, understanding EI. So I'm not going to talk more about those things until, of course, someone is really interested to know. You can write into me after the webinar and I can send you a whole load of details on any of these programs that you would be interested in doing it. It's all free and it is all in various format. We have recorded versions of webinars. We have live webinars, and we also can do one-on-one coaching based on any of your assessment that you would like to do with us. I have a question for you, and I really would like to see a raise of hands. How many of you have purchased and you have a copy of Daniel Goleman's book of Emotional Intelligence? I'm just getting into the chat box. Okay. So when I actually do this session in a large organizations and I asked people, how many of you have purchased? Literally around 75% of the hands go up saying, yes, I have got the book. And then I asked them the next question, which is, keep your hands up if you have actually started to read the book. So how many of you have, you know, read the book after purchasing it? And still some hands stay up saying, yeah, yeah, I have read, and continues to be. And then I asked them, how many of you have completed reading the entire book? And you can imagine it's actually half the hands coming down with only half reading. And then the most powerful question we ask is, if you act, you know, if you can actually tell us how much have you changed on how you show up in your life after you have read the book. How much have you changed in your behaviors or how you show up in your life after you have actually read the book? And, you know, I'm not able to see the hands up here, but I'm sure you know the answers, and this is what I get across when I do these sessions, is very, 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 very few. I think the recent conference, we had one of the people raising up to say, yes, I did some work after the reading of the book. So the whole idea is, how do you actually convert an EI into a basic everyday behavior? Unfortunately, a lot of them complicate EI, but to be very honest with you, EI is not a complicated subject. It's extremely simple, and you would see that right away. So emotional intelligence is definitely a success factor in every part of the organization. That's as for the time, what's your EQ conversation. And you can also see Daniel Goleman himself says that emotional intelligence is responsible for more than 85% of star performance in top leaders. And added to that, we also have Harvard Business Review, which says that EI accounts for nearly 90% of what moves people up the ladder. So these are all some of the proofs that you have about what it means to be knowing about EI. Before I get into this one and share with you, this is a real example of a big global organization. One more thing that I would like to share with you is the recent World Economic Forum report, which if you notice, for the 2020 as well as 2022, the top skills required to be at workforce, you would find EI very much there in the top 10 skills, which was not there if you look as latest as even 2015. So there's a huge change and shift in now, not only talking about EI, but actually practicing EI in every organization. And in one such organization is what this I'm going to share with you is about how there's a direct link between leaders' EI and employee engagement. So this was in IBM, and we did it in three countries, which is India, Canada, and US. And so India very much is part of this survey as well. We asked the direct reports of the senior leaders in IBM, and we asked the direct reports to share with us how much you know, their leaders actually demonstrate EI and how are they doing it in the organization. And then we realized that the answers that was given, that when a leader demonstrates high level of emotional intelligence, which is 75th percentile and above, that you can see here, the engaged employees under that leader are predominantly high. And these are the little bubbles. So these bubbles are the representations of the survey that you can see. And as it comes down, with the leader having very low EI, you see it's right here, it is actively disengaged, and this one is not engaged. So this is a definite relation in saying that when leaders demonstrate or show up every day at workplace with high EI, definitely they have you know, employee engaged, highly engaged people with them. So this was with IBM. I'm going to also share, so this is what I mean by this 75th percentile of just the difference of 75th percentile. You can see the highly engaged vis-a-vis what was not engaged here. And the next one that I'm going to share with you is about Sanofi. What we did was we actually trained, we actually made two groups intentionally, and one which was not trained on AI, and one group of people trained on AI. And you can see there was a huge difference in the sales numbers and sales success with AI trained sales people. And in Genos, we also have emotional intelligent assessments specifically for sales leaders and salesperson. So this is a clear indication of how, you know, it is moved up at an average of about the number that we have in place. The details regarding this research and more in-depth details, if anyone interested, both IBM as well as Sanofi, I can email it to you with the details post the session because it has more details into it. So this is what I was telling you about World Economic Forum. So since I've already spoken about it, I'm going to move a little ahead. So what does emotional intelligence impact in the real world that we live in, you and me? How does the world look like with high EI and low EI? So what I want you to do is now is when I need you to keep your paper and pen with you. And please be with me. I'm definitely going to give you a little time. So after everything, every time I ask you a question or a statement, I'm going to give you time to pen that down. So what I want you to do is, first of all, on a sheet of paper, right up there, I want you to think of a best boss that you ever worked. It could be either your boss or a co-worker, mentor, coach, teacher, anyone you can think of, one person. And please write down their name on top or initial, anything. Okay, now that you have written their name on top of the paper, I want you to draw a line under it. So if this is the paper, you've written the name on top, just put a line under that. And now what I want you to do is I want you to actually start rating this particular person, you know, your experience of your best ever boss, co-worker, mentor, coach, teacher, whoever. Please rate them one. So I'm going to actually put up a few statements for you in a little while. When the statement comes, read the statement and then rate them one, if it is significantly less than others, two, less than others, three, about typical, four, more than others, and fifth, significantly more than others. So five is higher, one is lower. So if you're ready, I'm going to ask the first question. This person whose name you have written, have they demonstrate or do they demonstrate awareness of their mood and emotions? If it is high, put you can five, or if it is one, two, three, four, up to you. So this is one classic example of what happened today. I actually came from Egypt yesterday morning. I landed at 3 o'clock and then I had to, like immediately from airport, had to fly into Chennai for a client's work and then came home late night yesterday. And while I was doing all this, I get a message from one of the clients saying that my, you know, 15 days of work is cancelled because of the precautionary measure that client is taking in terms of not having any sessions. So one, you know, it sort of really hit me. And obviously, you know, I was upset, angry, frustrated. You can really imagine what I was going through in terms of my emotions. And that's when my mother was trying to reach to me, to talk to me. And I know that with this kind of mood that I'm having, I might say something terrible. So I just quickly, I didn't take the call. I text my mom saying, I'm just going to call you back in a while. And then I actually sat down and sipped a little water, because that's what I always do when I get very flustered. I sipped a little water. And then I, you know, quickly, something that I live with is my paper and my book and my pen always in my bag. So I quickly pulled out a sheet, an empty sheet of the paper, and I started writing 10 things I'm grateful for today. Without even lifting the pen up, I just started writing whatever came to my head in terms of 10 things I'm really very grateful for. And believe it or not, when I actually finished it and when I read it, I felt so good. I felt so much nicer. And the very important fact is that, you know, I am with my husband, son, family. We are here, safe and sound. We are healthy and we are alive. And I think that sort of negates anything else in terms of finances or work or anything else. And I felt very, very good. So good thing is I didn't speak to my mom, because, you know, with that frustration, angry and upset, I would don't know what I would or how I would have actually spoken and also put her into jeopardy in terms of emotion. So demonstrating awareness of mood and emotion is when you really know what you go through and you recognize it. The second one is makes others feel appreciated. So go ahead and pen down this best ever boss that you worked with. How did that person make you feel? Did they feel you make you feel appreciated? Not only for the results, but even for the efforts that you put in to do something. That's the second one. Third one is about being open and honest about mistakes. And that's about, in fact, I always realize it's easy to sort of point out other people's mistakes. It takes a lot of guts and really, you know, open up your heart to say that I goofed it, I screwed it, I made this mistake, and that takes a lot to do. So this best ever boss you're thinking, or this person, were they open and honest about their mistakes? Were they vulnerable to, you know, stand up and say and own it up? Fourth, making ethical decisions. Whether someone is watching or no, they always make ethical decisions. Again, you can grade them. The next one is managing their emotions effectively in difficult situations. You know, especially when you goof up at workplace, do you have boss who react and start blaming and think, I told you, and start criticizing you? Or you have bosses who say, well, okay, I get it. We've done the mistake. Let's take a deep breath, calm, and let's see what we can do. So how do they really react and manage their emotions in difficult situations? And the last one, recognizes others' hard work and achievements. So if you have scored for on these six statements, what I want you to now do is please total those scores and draw a line under your ratings. So ideally, it should have been your name, the number, and put a score and put a big line there, because we're going to do another activity now. Okay. So how did your best boss make you feel? So now I want you to quickly write down without thinking too much. Consider how did you feel when you were around this person? If you can, you know, quickly write down at least 3 to 4 feelings or emotions when you think about this person, please. Without thinking much, just think of this person and, you know, the top 3 feelings or emotions which come up. Okay. If you have done.
Okay,
sorry. The thing that I want you to do is, how well did your best boss motivate you? So basically here I'm talking about the discretionary effort That is the level of efforts people could give if they wanted to, but above and beyond the minimum required. So for example, you go way beyond to do something for this person or for the team because of the kind of feeling that you have. I want you to rate it this way. So it's basically about going the extra mile. So how much did your best boss motivate you to go to the extra mile? 1, 2, 3 is obviously the lower side. 8, 9, 10 is definitely I would do anything for this person and I'll go extra mile. And 4, 5, 6, 7 is typically the, okay, yeah, maybe, you know, things like that. So you could just write down a number. All right. Now what I want you to do is take a fresh sheet of paper, another sheet, and think about the worst ever boss or co-worker, mentor, coach, or teacher you have come across. I remember, Derek McCann, who's the sales head of sales international at Jenner's. He uses something called as psychic vampires. You know, these are the people who can actually suck the entire energy out of you. And somehow, even if you're highly positive, can infuse and induce negative and say that, well, I've done my job. I'm thinking of those kind of people, and I'm sure we all have one. When you think of that person, you know, write down on top their name. And then again, we do the same thing. Pen it down 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. For the worst ever boss, co-worker, mentor, coach, teacher, whoever you had. Demonstrate awareness of their mood and emotions. Makes others feel appreciated. Is very open, honest about mistakes. Makes ethical decisions. Manages their emotions effectively in difficult situations and recognizes others' hard work and achievements. Okay, like before, if you have completed, then please total the score and draw a line under your ratings. And again, we write down, you know, how did this person make you feel, emotions, what kind of things, maybe top 3, 4 that come to your mind. Okay. Now we're back again for discretionary effort, which is going the extra mile. How much did your worst boss motivate you to go to the extra mile? Again, 1, 2, 3, nah. 8, 9, 10, definitely yes. And 4, 5, 6, 7 is, yeah, okay. All right, so just have one number for this one. So what was your score for the best boss, co-worker, mentor, coacher? Anyone who can either say it aloud or you can type it in the chat box and we can all read it. So I'm not able to see the number. Aishwarya, you're able to see the number? Maybe you could.
Yes, yes, I can very well see the number. If you keep on chat, you'll be able to see the number also, Vanita.
Okay, I'm actually on chat, but I am only able to see the pictures and videos and photographs of people. So I don't know.
You click on the chat. There's a box next to the share, which is chat.
I did. I'm actually there, but I'm still not able to actually.
So the numbers are coming high. So they're 28, 24, 26.
Fantastic.
From 28 to 30.
Yeah, that's expected. Yeah, thank you. What about
28
the
for you?
Sorry?
28 for you.
28. Fantastic. Thank you. What about worst boss, co-worker?
11.
7.
11. Typically, yes, because keeping the number in mind of 1 to 5. So the minimum can be six. But in fact, when we were doing this webinar a few months back, I had someone who actually scored minus three. So you can imagine, you know, even now when they think of this person, they're like, they really tank their emotions down. That's kind of effect they left leave on them. So yeah, thank you. So what are the kind of emotions again coming up when you think of this best boss?
Feeling valued.
Yeah, definitely.
Giving space to experiment and excel.
Oh yeah, innovation, creativity. Bang on.
Secure. Relaxed.
Oh yeah, definitely. Secure, relaxed.
And supported. Feel supported.
Thank you.
Empowered, happy.
Yeah, sure, go ahead. Happy.
So, Vanita, I felt valued, respected, and engaged.
Wow, fantastic. All the three good words, and that is true as well. What about the worst boss, co-worker, mentor? How did you feel with these people around?
Oh, I felt frustrated, low morale, as well as disengaged.
Oh, yeah. Sad. Yeah, the constant.
They left the organization.
Oh, my God. I know. Run away from the negativity. I get that feeling. Trust me. And I've had a boss like this and I was hospitalized for 2 days because of the high stress of working with this gentleman. And I would never forget that even today. Yeah, that was crazy. But I get what you're saying.
So
I think this is the idea. Sorry. Yeah.
Yeah, Ganesh is saying angry, repulsive. Raju is saying wanting to sabotage, vicious.
Oh my God.
Stressful, oh, yeah. Doubtful, fear, confused. Kate says like a robot.
Oh boy.
insecure and distrust.
Oh yes, big time. Okay.
So I was just like you, I was hospitalized, went through some treatment.
Oh my God.
Came back from treatment the previous night, and I get up at 8:30 in the morning. My boss calls me and he says, good morning. And those were his best words for the next 45 minutes. So the rest was, well, I think there's a lot of unprintable language, so I won't go into that.
That's very true. But, you know, isn't it very beautiful? I don't know when this experience you had, but you're actually narrating it. It's as though it happened today morning.
Yeah, it happened to me in 2010.
Oh, boy. That's like a decade back.
That's a long time ago.
True.
But you know what? I think it took me 4 years to see his side of the story. I won't forgive him for that, but then there was the other side of the story as well. But
I agree. I get that. Yeah. Yeah. That's exactly what we're talking about today. And, you know, the whole idea is in understanding on what I keep saying on how someone shows up, irrespective of the stories you carry, because how you show up is how you make others feel. And that is as much as an EI that I can give you in a very simple format with a simple definition on. And I, in fact, in Genos, we use this EI mantra is how you show up is how you make others feel. It's as simple as that. So there is no excuse for how you show up. So you can't say I'm angry or I'm frustrated because of you. I'm irritated because you're not getting what I'm saying. Well, that's actually so much easier to put on someone else. But the idea is on how you really choose to show up every day. So how much did the best boss motivate you go the extra mile? Any number?
Almost 10.
Sorry?
Almost 10.
Almost 10. Yeah, that's true. And how much did the worst boss motivate you to go to the extra mile?
Very surprisingly, I was thinking whether I should mark him lower, but actually it was 7. But it was in a very negative way, because just because he was what he was didn't mean that I wouldn't go the extra mile. I think I was bracing against on my own, but it wasn't really the positive way of taking me there. It was
true.
A 7, but mostly one's own willpower and one's own...
Very true. The self-awareness being very high. In fact, you know, I also have met people who have told me that sometimes the worst bosses get the best out of you because you just want to run away. You try to do something good to either run away from the department, do exceptionally well and move to another department or to another organization. And sometimes right. that could also happen. But predominantly, I think we all know that the worst boss, coworker, or you know, anyone for that matter, definitely don't make you go the extra mile for them.
Right.
So, yeah, sorry, please go ahead.
Add, Vanita, that when you find really good bosses in the beginning of your career, they serve as some great benchmarks to ensure you are insulated with the bad ones. But if you get the real bad ones in the beginning, that is more scarring than when you get them later.
I completely agree with you, and that's true. I because I've gone through the same experience that you say. And hence, you know, I'm actually going to summarize by Maya Angelou's beautiful quote, which I live by, is people definitely forget what you said, people forget what you did, but they never, ever forget how you made them feel. And today when you were narrating the story of the hospital, it felt like today because you narrated it just like that, with the feeling of what you have gone through at that moment. So that pretty predominantly summarizes what I keep saying in terms of the way you show up definitely impacts the way people feel. So we actually call it emotional contagious. That's how you can pass it on. So REI mantra is, like I said, the way you show up determines the way people feel. And the way they feel determines the extent to which they can be engaged. So look at the words you all used when you were thinking about the best person you were associated with, and think about the words you were talking about, the feelings you know when you associate yourself with the worst boss that you can work with. And hence, engaged employees or engaged people determine everything about the outcome of that relationship. So this is the EI mantra that I'm leaving it for you today, and I'm going to give you 10 seconds to soak it up. So this is the premise in which Genos works, because we are the only organization in the world who have assessments based on 42 behaviors. So that's exactly what I'm going to show you. So if you look at our EI model, it's very simple. In fact, the six statements that I asked you for you to rate, we actually picked up one from every part of the EI. So the first one was about self-awareness. When you have it high, you're definitely present. And if you're having it low, you're disconnected. So the white circle that you see is on the lower side. Not productive behaviors. And the gray ones are the productive behaviors. So the next one was about makes others feel appreciated, which is awareness of others. being open and honest is about authenticity. Then comes emotional reasoning. Then comes self-management, and finally inspiring performance. So if you actually notice, the six statements that you have actually rated people are the six behaviors. In fact, what we have is in Genos, we have around seven behaviors per skill. So self-awareness is seven behaviors. So what I've shared with you is one of the behavior out of that. So it's as simple as that. In fact, my fourth grade son understands EI so well, because one, he keeps hearing me doing the webinar and assessments, and he sort of knows these behaviors so well because they are in simple English, simple language, and very easy to connect and understand. So that is the first part of my, the webinar in terms of understanding. So now you understand what EI is in terms of, in its simplicity, is the way you behave or the way you show up. Now what we're going to do is understanding the basic neuroscience. I'm not getting into in-depth of it. Maybe we can have another one if you're interested sometime during the year or next year on in-depth neuroscience, which David Rock and pioneers like Dan Siegel have been talking and doing about in neuroleadership and neuroscience-based EI. So what I'm going to talk about is something, again, based on Dan Siegel. And if you notice this, it's about keeping your fingers this way and holding it. And that's literally your mouth. So assume that this is your face and this is your mouth. And the wrist that you see from here would be your spinal cord. So that would typically be your, I would say the eyes here, and this is the wrist, this is the mouth. So the spine. So if you look at, you know, in the, like say around 4,000 years ago, or, you know, the prehistoric that you would think about, we call this as the reptile brain. So in fact, you can actually share, this is an easy way that I actually talk about the brain model to children as well, and they love it. So, you know, you could actually think about this as your reptile brain right here. And 400 million years ago, if you take that into mind, basically this part of the brain, you know, is more about the keeping the body alive. It sort of helps you hold on to it. And, you know, it sort of regulates your body, including immune systems, keep it breathing, and the regular stuff that it does. Now think about the next one, which is when you open this way and, when you look at this part, which is your, so the four fingers are your modern brain. And the thumb that you see, if you know David Rock's scarf model, it talks about threat and reward, and I'm going to talk about that in a little while. So basically, this is what is the monkey there, you know, telling you that every trigger which sort of gets into you is either gets into the reward or either gets into the threat, depending on the trigger. So the four fingers of the modern brain, and that's predominantly where sort of we live, which is our thinking brain, and which we call as the PFC, the prefrontal cortex. So if you now look at this, when you hold on to this way, you know, this is where the whole thinking happens. So if you keep it this way, imagine this part is right here. So you have your eyes and ears, and then exactly behind this is what this comes. And this predominantly drives in everything that we do. So if you actually notice, it's a very small thing in the brain. However, you know, as much as people keep telling me, you know, Vanita, I'm very logical when it comes, I'm more fact-driven. People somehow abhor when I tell them about emotions. They say, but I am not emotional. I say, yeah, you may not be emotional, but you definitely do have emotions. And that sort of reminds me of a story that I would like to, you know, quickly share with you. It's again, I've taken it from the, if you're interested, again, I can send this link to you. It's from the Charter for Compassion. It's a website called charterforcompassion.org. And this is from Junos, this article. So this is about a line manager. His name is Steven. And he says, I don't go in for any of that fluffy stuff at work. Feelings should be kept at home and kept out of work. So this was the first few words he used against the coach, who actually sat down to do his 360-degree Genos emotional intelligent assessment. So that sort of nails for the coach about the way, you know, Stephen is showing up. And the whole point is that people assume that emotions are not meant for job or workplace. And this is not what we should be looking at. So, you know, it took a lot where... the coach had to literally make Steven sit down and sort of make him understand with certain wordings. And you can read this whole story in this Charter for Compassion, where he actually starts with few questions and make him really understand. In fact, the first question he sort of asks is, how engaged are your people? And what do you think your staff are talking about you? And, you know, and stuff like that. So it's very interesting that we assume that we are good. However, the whole idea is what others think of us. And that's where it really works out. So the neuroscience itself proves that any trigger or anything that happens first gets into the emotional, you know, mind. And then maybe, you know, makes you sort of think. And what happens is, when this happens, there are two critical neurotransmitters which come. One, which is called the oxytocin, the trust hormone that we talk about. And next is the cortisol, which is a stress hormone. Now, it's again proven that excessive cortisol diminishes the response to the oxytocin. So the whole idea is that, you know, if you don't get this one right in terms of understanding, like every time there is this behavior which comes up, it sort of moves into, and over a period of time, too much of stress, like the examples of hospitalization, until of course you're self-aware to come out of it and you say, okay. And you also said that it took you a few years to really understand the other side of the story. But the point is that, you know, excessive cortisol literally diminishes the response to the oxytocin. And hence, imagine in an organization where there is absolutely no trust between the leader and his team. And if that continues, you can imagine the kind of dent that would bring into the organization. So it's very simple. This is the summary of what I was telling you. Every time there's a stimulus, the emotional brain either decides that this is a danger or a threat. And that's again on the how you show up. And hence it diminishes fear, lack of security. And if you can notice, all these words you were associating with that worst boss that we were thinking about. And so literally means that everything that is happening, you know, gives you the feelings, decision, and either engagement up or down based on that. And if it is reward, then obviously, you know, you have trust, approval, sense of belonging, fairness, valued, respected. And then that takes into, you know, the decisions, feelings, and engage. So the summary of this is very simple. How you show up is how you make others feel. How others feel makes them engaged, and how engaged determines literally everything in an organization. So it either go down or it can go spiraling high up. So this is by Gordon in 2002, very clearly says about everything you do in life is based upon your brain, determination to minimize danger and maximize reward. So minimize threats and maximize rewards is the organization principle of the brain. And that's so true. And that's why sometimes some people, some situations and some words can either make us go this way or go that way on, you know, high or low. It's because of the people. And sometimes you would have realized we would have met someone and they have created this, like the moment you meet them, you feel this calm. You feel a lot of positivity. You feel the warmth when they walk into the room and you can really feel the energy in there. And there are sometimes, like I said, the psychic vampires who can, even when you are positive, can pull out and make you feel the other way around. So the whole idea of neuroscience of emotions is either you can help people, you know, away from threat response or towards rewards response. So the whole idea is you must know how they show up to themselves right now. And also important is how they show up to others right now. So that is self-awareness and awareness of others. And also some disparities of which I call rose-colored glasses, which is about, I think I'm good, whereas the whole world around me thinks that, oh, I suck. The other way is black-colored glasses, where I am so critical about my own self. And both aren't very good in terms of you show up at workplace. And the whole idea is you have your emotional intelligence, emotional intelligence edge, which is how you demonstrate the behavior that, you know, you can action to trigger that can change. So there are some people, like you said, about that boss of yours, where he used to be a trigger for threat. However, now after 4 years understanding his story, maybe no more a threat when you look at that person on Converse with them anytime. So when you are a coach and when you're coaching, I'm sure you come across the situations where you really discuss about behaviors. So using neuroscience and the approach towards understanding what really is about, it's not about the periphery behavioral change, but much deeper to it. So I'm sure you would have heard about David Rock, his fantastic book on quiet leadership. I'm actually also RCS results Coaching System is the company that David Rock founded, and I'm certified by him, and I met him in Bombay as well. Fantastic human being. And what I really like about he putting this in a very simple format for us, which is called SCARF. And I know ICFRC, especially RC as coaching uses SCARF methodology of coaching, which typically talks about the stages, certainty, autonomy, relatedness, and fairness. And I'm going to quickly walk you through one by one. So status is all about importance relative to others. That means an increase in status generates a larger neural response than money. People feel connected if you make them feel important in what they do. A decrease in status triggers the brain's pain matrix to the high level. And hence, show everyone you work with what's great about them, but please be genuine about it. So that means it's not about just looking at the results, however, also observing the efforts that they put in at all the time, that you can say that, hey, I know I've been observing, you know, you really put in efforts and you are important. It talks about that. Next come is certainty and ability to predict the future. And our brains are certainly seeking machines, you know, any ambiguity triggers a threat response. And I think no better than the situation we are today in, which is with the COVID-19 happening around, is a certainty that I think this is something that we're all looking for. So make expectations, commitments, and structures extremely clear when working with them. Like how during our coaching, we, you know, set all these very clearly even before we do our coaching talking or even coaching intervention with our coachees. We have our expectation, commitment, and structure. So that's very clear and they know what is going to come out of our intervention with them. The next one is autonomy, a sense of control over events. So when we experience stresses, the threat response is dramatically higher if we feel we have no control about the situation. Work on providing a feeling of choice, of control, of autonomy in every situation. Try to offer alternatives and maybe some sense of choice. And that's, I think, what we do as coaches fantastically for our coachees. Even in situations where they feel it's the end of the tunnel, we somehow make way for them to see beyond and we help them. So I think this is fantastic in what we do as coaching intervention. Relatedness is all about a sense of belonging and connection. So it's either new or different people trigger a threat response. So when we have newer boss, newer co-workers, we can either on the way we show up, on the way we start, like the good morning that you stated, it could either be a threat or a trigger. So what can we do? Build trust and a sense of what we have in common, bringing people together socially in terms of shared goals. And you can literally press the flesh. That's what I mean. And that's, I think, something that we people right now in the call have all in common of relatedness in terms of understanding EI in our everyday behavior. Fairness, of course, is a perception of equal treatment and fairness. So unfair interactions or systems generate a huge threat response. And hence, be more than fair, be generous with all and be seen doing so. Because all must feel they're being treated fairly. And it is not about the ratings or, you know, the money you make or the designations you get. It's about just being fair. And I think we have had, when you think about the best bosses you've worked, it's not that the best bosses always gave you the money or the designation or the promotion. It's sometimes also giving very, you know, I would say feedback or ideas that really made us jolt up and start thinking about it. So it could be that as well. So with that, I think I'm literally on time with we have 4 minutes to go. But however, yeah, that's about the EI in how you show up determines how you make others feel. And that's what I had in store for you for this 1 hour.
So thank you so much, Vanika.
For sure.
So much. And Vishal has a question. He's raising his hand.
Sure.
Yes, Vishal, you can unmute yourself and go ahead.
Yes. Hi, Vanita.
Hi, Vishal.
Thank you for such an interesting presentation.
Thank you.
My question is around fairness. See, yep. Of all the things, fairness, to my mind, is a difficult one because everybody seems to have different matrices for fairness.
True.
So how do you bridge that gap? Because for somebody, a 50-50 split is fair. But for somebody else, it has to be 60 in their favor and 40 in mine for them to think that that's fair. Because everybody has different ideas of their contribution, et cetera, et cetera. So that's a tough one to get my mind around. Could you help?
Sure. In fact, I may not fully answer your question, Vishal, but I will try with the live example, what I did when I was working as a manager in a multinational bank. And I was the vice president for learning and development for South India. You're absolutely right, because fairness is very different for individual. So one of the things I really do is fairness is, I don't treat it like separately, right? One, it is part of the whole intervention of our behaviors with that individual. So one, whenever I've had new people or when I've become a new boss in any organize or any, you know, in any teams, I first few days or weeks, I literally spend knowing them in and out. In fact, I go to that depth level of understanding how somebody likes appreciation. For example, some people like shusha, call everybody, clap and make a big show, whereas some people just like a pat on the back. So what I do is, including fairness, is about really understanding the person, their little bit of background, their values, which I my absolute favorite is knowing people's values. Even while coaching, I actually spend time in understanding my coachee in terms of this, so that it's so much easier in my conversation with that person as to what I can bring in individual value that would be impactful. So you actually answered partially your question, because fairness is very relative and we need to find out and then accordingly give. But I think overall as a blanket, it's about you as a person and how you show up. And even if you have done something unfair, do you really, you know, have the guts to stand up and say, yeah, I goofed it up. I'm sorry. I learned my lesson. I'm really going to think about it. Now that really negates that as well.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So if anybody else has any question, you can either type in the chat box or you can raise your hand. We just have one more minute and we just take one more question. Yes, please.
Yeah. Hi, Vanita. This is Puneet here.
Hi, Puneet.
Hi, how are you? The lovely session. And I just wanted to know that as a part of the self-discovery, you know, we do have 360, we have Hogan, we have all other kind of inventories that are being used in coaching today.
True.
Where does this fit in? Is this self-sufficient, or where does this fit in the large scheme of things? And how does most use it from the purpose of coaching?
Sure. So that's a very good question. Thank you for asking that. Like I said, when I personally was looking out to get certified in EI, I also had Daniel Goleman Institute, and with all due respect to them, they are fantastic. But me as an individual, if you notice, my company name is also Radical Edge, is because I'm very radical in the way I think. And for me, I was looking at how can I get EI in a very basic level for anyone to understand, including students, because I do a lot of work with EI with students as well, because they are the future and we really need to help them. So if you look at an organization, for me, EI, Genos EI especially, focuses on behavior. We have 42 behaviors which make you highly intelligent with your emotions, and hence it can be fit in anywhere you want, depending on the interventions you're doing with your clients. For example, I have done it with a team where they were very, very poor, low engaged team. So we were looking at the engagement part of it. I've also done emotional intelligence assessment of Genos for sales team to bring up their sales number. I've also done for HR business partners, because they were having tough time with the internal business heads, and they wanted to have a cohesive and trust-based relationship. Because Genos assessment is on behaviors, it's about individual and how you show up. The whole idea is it's so much easy for you to integrate it wherever you want in any situation. So you can do Genos EI along with 360 degree of something else if you want to, because that focus could be very different. You could also do it with Hogan, And anything, any other assessment you think deemed fit?
Sure. Is there a Genos team report also?
Oh, yes, we do. We have selection report. So you can actually look at hiring. Like recently I had a case in Sri Lanka. I see someone from Sri Lanka here. So they were actually deciding between two people as to who should be, you know, given that position. While, you know, they asked us this question, you know, we were very frank in saying that, you know, only on EI, you might not be able to select, but definitely EI plays a bigger role because these two people were extremely good in what they do. They were talented, extremely knowledgeable. However, the biggest concern was, will they be able to lead the organization in the ethos it was created? And one of the biggest challenge the director and the founder of that company had was, who's going to lead after me? With somebody who's really passionate and with a heart, not only the mind. And then EI in selection report brilliantly worked for that organization as well.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you,
Kanish. Hi, Vanita, I have got a question for you.
Yeah, sure. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Do we have time for that?
You'll have to ask Aishwarya. Or you can connect with me separately. Aishwarya,
that's okay. Adhir, we can take it if it's a short one.
Okay.
Yes, Vanita. In a coaching conversations, very often we find coaches exhibiting different emotions at different times. So what's the importance of EI in a coaching conversation?
So like if you notice the whole Vana that we've been talking about is also about the way you feel and how you show up in the conversation when they go through those kind of myriads of emotions, you know, and displaying it. I'm sure you've come across coaches who are very, coaches who are very stoic, coaches who just don't want to get into coaching conversation because their bosses or HR pushed them into it. So when they come across all these, one is, you know, having self-awareness and also awareness of others. And I think for me, most important in my coaching conversations is making them realize that it is okay. In fact, you know, if you notice, we say that anger is not even an emotion anymore. We say anger is actually the outcome of something much more deeper. It could be insecure. It could be wanting to be heard. So especially when I do EI counseling for children, you see the anger that they display, trust me, is just an outcome. What they really want deep down is very, very different thing. So it takes a lot in coaching conversations as well. Sometimes silence, which coaches display, can also mean a lot deeper that they're carrying inside them. So as coaches, when we are aware of it and we first make them aware, then the coaching conversation becomes very richer and impactful.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Adhir. And we cannot take any more questions now, but if you have any more questions, please feel free to write to me and we will take it offline with Vanita. Thank you, Vanita, so much for the wonderful session. And I have posted the link for earning the CCUs. Please copy the link and save it and submit your form within 24 hours. Vanita, a special mention regarding the way you explained the neuroscience model using the fist and the arm. Okay. But that was something very novel to me. Being a doctor, I never ever thought, you know, this could be a representation of a neuroscience. And thank you so much for that.
Maybe this is a new coronavirus, hello. You know, virtually also I'm doing this. So thank you very much.
Thank you so much. And thank you everybody for being there. And have a wonderful evening.
Thank you very much for the opportunity.
Thank you everyone.
Have a great evening. God bless. Bye-bye.
Thanks, Aishwarya. Bye, Vanita.
Thanks, Aishwarya.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you.